السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. My dear brothers and sisters, first and foremost, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that once again He has given us a day of life, a day of good health, a day of happiness, and a day in which He has given us the opportunity to talk about Him and to be close with Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sayyidina Ali karamallahu ta'ala wajhul kareem, he said that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows one blessing upon you, when Allah gives you one ni'mah, say alhamdulillah. When Allah gives you one blessing, what is one blessing? Waking up is a blessing. Seeing is a blessing. Being able to touch is a blessing. Keep going and keep going and keep going. So imagine how many blessings we've been granted just today from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So imagine how many times we should be saying alhamdulillah. And the more times we appreciate Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more Allah ta'ala will give us. Because He says, la in shakartum la azidannakum. The more you thank me, I'll give you more. Sayyidina Imam Ali karamallahu ta'ala wajhul kareem, he said, when Allah bestows one ni'mah to you, say alhamdulillah. When you are afflicted by harm, just remain patient. It's because the one who gives you the ni'mah is Allah. Even when someone is being nice to you, someone gives you a gift, someone helps you, it's really Allah Ta'ala's help. So thank Allah. Thank the person and thank Allah. It's also important to thank people as well, because whoever does not thank the people, he or she cannot thank Allah. And people who can't thank each other, then how can they thank or even think about thanking the Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala? So appreciation is something that we need to ensure that we are always people who appreciate each other and appreciate help and appreciate each other's support and appreciate good things, my brothers and sisters. It's very important. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His blessings, and I was saying Sayyidina Imam Ali, he said, and when you are afflicted by harm, then remain patient. Because why should you remain patient when you're afflicted with harm? It's because Allah Ta'ala will remove that harm from you. The same Creator who gave you a blessing, who has the power to give you the blessing, He is the same Creator who will remove harm from you. That's why we have to be patient when we are afflicted by harm. Khair, last week I remember I was talking about the importance of realizing the importance of educating ourselves as parents, as elders, and how as parents and elders, how we need to be leaving behind the inheritance, the wiratha of ilm, the wiratha of adab, as opposed to just leaving behind, you know, so many titles as in, you know, properties and so much equity, so and so forth. Alhamdulillah, I was informed, as Brother Nurul Hassan mentioned to us in the last week's announcement, if you're paying attention, that they are running here part-time HIFS classes and full-time HIFS classes. So we should, you know, benefit from these classes. We should send our children. And I'm sure you can, even if you're an adult and you want to learn the Quran, Maulana Yunus or Imam Hafiz Adil can teach you. The whole point is, children learn from parents. And children want to learn when parents want to learn. And when parents don't want to learn, children don't want to learn. That's how it is. You say to your child, read the Quran. And you don't want to read the Quran. You want to call your friend and you say, oh, guess what happened yesterday? You know him? Oh, let me tell you what happened yesterday. So now he's reading the Quran and you are talking about what he said, what she said. And your child will read the Quran for 2 minutes and he'll say, you know, daddy, so what did he say then? Tell me. again, the point is, we need to read the Quran as elders, as adults, and inshallah, they are, I'm sure they have classes, and you can, you know, honestly, the teachers are available. The teachers are always available. Where are the students? The ulama are always available. Where are those who really want to aim from them? You know, nowadays people want to come to ulama just to talk about, you know, things which they shouldn't even bring up in front of ulama or in front of teachers. Whereas when we come to a teacher, one should come as the thirsty goes to the well. And one should take from that teacher the nur and the wealth that that teacher carries. And I'm coming to the point of what I want to talk about is, today I want to talk about the niyyah, the power of the niyyah, the importance of niyyah, the importance of rectifying the niyyah. How important is our niyyah? Because we can all right now, the least we can do right now, and what we have to do right now, sitting now, in the house of Allah Ta'ala, in the presence, in the hadra of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, in the presence of the angels who are gathered in this house of His during this time, which is a very time where, you know, when the khutbah starts, the ulama, the muhaddithin have written, this in the hadith of Sayyidina Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when you come for the khutbah and the khutbah begins, the angels now, they surround the majlis on Yawm al-Jum'ah. So this is a time that we make the niyyah, I make the niyyah, not just you, me as well. We all make the niyyah that inshaAllah ta'ala, we will, or I will inshaAllah ta'ala, I will spend it. I will study the Quran inshaAllah ta'ala every single day of my life. Bi-idhnillah. We can make this niyyah, can't we? It doesn't cost anything. No pledge form needed. No credit card needed. Nothing. We make the niyyah. So we made the niyyah. Everyone made the niyyah? Alhamdulillah. InshaAllah. Now we've made the niyyah. Let me tell you what Sayyidina Imam Ali karamallahu ta'ala wajhahu kareem. I was reading something today, subhanAllah. I was preparing the khutbah and I read something, I said, SubhanAllah. Sayyidina Imam Ali karramallahu ta'ala wajhahu al-kareem, he said that the reward of a good niyyah is greater than the reward of a good action. The reward of a good niyyah is greater than the reward of a, you know, I'll give you an example. How much is the masjid project? How much do we need to make this masjid project complete? 16 million? 13 million. Okay. If someone says, someone comes right now, and inshallah, one day, inshallah, may Allah ta'ala make someone come, inshallah, inshallah. I mean, and we make the need, inshallah, if Allah ta'ala gives me tomorrow 13 million, inshallah, I will give that money. But, you know, obviously time will tell. But then if the niyyah is sincere, then inshallah, Allah will facilitate. Our job is to make niyyah, Allah Ta'ala's job is, you know, to facilitate things. Khair, $13 million. I'm explaining to you, according to Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala, who's saying that a good niyyah, the reward of a good niyyah is greater than the reward of a good action. If someone says, okay, I'm going to give $13 million, I'll give you a draft, or I'll wire the money into your account. Is that more virtuous? Or is it virtuous if you make the niyyah that inshallah, ya Allah Ta'ala, you give me 13 million, I will donate 13 million to World Islamic Mission. What is greater? What do you think is greater? Someone gives 13 million. Because one would say, you know, if you're making the niyyah to give 13 million, you could change on your niyyah. Isn't that correct? So the one who's actually come and actually writing, who's at the bank right now, and he's getting this draft made, obviously he should have a greater reward. But guess what Sayyidina Imam Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa karramallahu ta'ala wa karim, Babul ilm wal hikmah, SubhanAllah. And I don't know, obviously, if you know, but we should know, but there's a verse in the Quran from Surah Al-Ma'idah where Allah Ta'ala says, Ya أيها الرسول بلغ ما أنزل إليك من ربك وإن لم تفعل فما بلغت رسالته. But O Prophet, spread, you know, convey and declare that which Allah Ta'ala has revealed to you. Declare that which your Lord has revealed to you. Verse of the Quran. And if you don't declare it, if you don't announce it, then truly you have not spread, and you have not then, if you do not declare or announce that what your Lord has revealed to you, then فَمَا بَلَّغْتَ رِسَالَةً, then you have not spread the whole message in entirety. What was this spreading? This spreading was Imam Fakhruddin al-Razi, he writes, فَلَمَّا نَزَلَتْ هَذِهِ الْآيَةِ, because the 18th of Dhul-Hijjah is the day where the Prophet ﷺ made a declaration, and the Quran talks about this declaration, so does the authentic Sunnah. We have the hadith in of Imam Nasa'i and other riwayas as well. But what was this declaration? When the verse was revealed, Razi writes in his tafsir, Mafatih al-Ghayb, he writes, فَلَمَّا نَزَلَتْ هَذِهِ الْآيَةِ, he says, when this verse was revealed, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam أَخَذَ بِيَدِ عَلِي, he grabbed the hand of Sayyidina Ali karamallahu ta'ala wa jalla kareem, and he said, مَنْ كُنْتُ مَوْلَاهُ فَعَلِيهُ مَوْلَاهُ, whoever's master I am, Ali is his master. Allahumma wali man wala wa adi man ada. And in another narration of An-Nasa'i, he said, O Allah, befriend the one who befriends Ali, and O Allah, the one who shows enmity towards Ali, you declare them as your enemies. Why am I talking about Sayyidina Ali? Because he's Babul Ilm. He is the gate of knowledge, he's the gate of wisdom. And our Hafiz Adil's Shaykh, Sayyid Nasiruddin Nasir rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, one day he was giving a lecture and he said that, last week I was talking about ta'aleem, education. He said, look at the word ta'aleem. Look at the word, spell the word ta'aleem. Ta'aleem, lam, ya, meem. If you take out Ali, there's no ta'aleem. And that's why the muhaddithin, they said, the muhaddithin, the hadith says, if you want knowledge, then go to the door. You want to enter my house? Enter from the door. You're going to enter from the back? I'm going to call the police. And you see, we need to talk about Sayyidina Ali karamallahu ta'ala wa jalla kareem. If we want spirituality, what's better, spirituality? I know in today's day and age you can buy lots of things. You know, you can buy cars, you can buy this, you can buy that. You can buy people. You know, you can buy lots of people nowadays. You can't buy ma'rifah, my brothers and sisters. You can't buy ilm. You can't buy hikmah. You can't go to the grocery store and say, I want 10 pounds of ma'rifah, 10 kg ma'rifah, 10 kg wisdom. You can't do that. You go to the gate of knowledge, the gate of wisdom, and that's exactly what we're doing. Because we want to develop an educational system. As Muslims, we need to know we need education. And the Prophet said, I'm the city of knowledge. Medina is the city of knowledge. It's the house of wisdom. You want to enter that house, you want to go, then connect to the one who's the gate of that knowledge and that wisdom, of that haqiqa, of that ma'rifah. And that is Ali ibn Abi Talib, karamallahu ta'ala wajhal kareem. And that's why even amongst the Khulafa al-Rashideen al-Mahdiyeen, Sayyidina Ali karamallahu ta'ala wajhal kareem, he was the one, he was the qari, he was the scholar amongst them, and they would go and consult and take ilm from him. This Quran that we have, the nukta, the zabar zair pesh, the tashkeel that we have, that came from the student of Sayyidina Ali karamallahu ta'ala wajhal kareem, Abu al-Asad Duali. The grammar on the Quran we got because of Ali. We got because of Ali. He said, Sayyidina Ali karamallahu ta'ala wajhal kareem. You know, people came from Hajj recently, and I'll talk about Hajj quickly and wrap things up inshaAllah ta'ala. But the poet, he said Ali nal bughz rakhe ऐवें तू निकम्मे आ, अली नाल बुझ रखे ऐवें तू निकम्मे आ. ਮੇਰਾ ਉੱਥੇ ਤੇਰਾ ਹਜ ਹੋਵੇ ਜਿੱਥੇ ਅਲੀ ਜਮਿਆ You know, he says, you have bughs, like you don't like the name of Ali. We can talk about everyone, from A to Z, from Hazrat to Hazrat to this to Hazrat. And I'm talking about Ali. The Sunni, the Nabawi Sunnah. The Sunni is the one who follows the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Authentic Sunni. The authentic Sunni is the one who talks about Ali. The poet says that you have animosity towards Ali, you can't stand his mentioning. You are going to perform a Hajj where he was born. This is Ali Karamallahu Ta'ala Wajhahu Kareem. He's the Babul Ilm. Look, read about him, my brothers and sisters. And one may say, you know, this Maulana, you know, they say to me, wherever this Maulana goes, he talks about Ali. You see, if I'm standing in Masjid Nurul Haram, then I'm going to be talking about the Nur of the Haram. Because Ali is the Nur of Haram.
Subhanallah.
Ali is the Nur of Haram. And I talk about the one whom Allah Ta'ala talked about and whom the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam talked about. And the one who is really, Ali is basically the mark of Iman. And the more distant we are from Ali, the closer we are to Nifaq. And the closer we are to Ali, the closer we are to faith. You know, nowadays the biggest problem in the world, I'm coming to the climax of my khutbah. What is the biggest problem in the world right now? Amongst us Muslims. Or generally in the corporate world, dealing with the world, in the world, what is the biggest problem? In my opinion, and correct me if I'm wrong, the biggest problem is hypocrisy. Yes or no? Hypocrisy, nifaq. You know? Donambri. Hypocrisy. You know, fraud, deception. Why did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, O Ali in Bukhari, he said, O Ali, the one who loves you is a mu'min, the one who has animosity towards you, in other words, the one who doesn't like to talk about you or those who talk about you, he basically that person, you know, targets them or basically badmouths them. The Prophet said, the one who loves you is a mu'min, and the one who's close to you, Ali, is a mu'min, the one who's away from you is a munafiq. But you see, what you have to bear in mind is when I talk about Ali, I'm talking about following Ali after following the Quran, after following the authentic prophetic sunnah, after following the authentic prophetic sunnah. I'm talking about loving and following Ali like Sayyidina Abu Bakr wa Umar wa Uthman. Like Mu'inuddin followed Ali. Like Bu Ali Qalandar followed Ali. This is what I'm saying. Hypocrisy. That's the reason we need to talk about Ali. We need to follow Ali. Because he dealt with the most hypocrisy, my brothers and sisters. Read about his life. He told us, remember? If you are afflicted with pain, be patient. He told us that when hypocrisy comes to you, don't become a hypocrite. Stay a believer. Stay a believer. Be persistent, persevere, be patient. Don't be involved in deceiving people. Remain as a believer. This is the way of Ali. Resist. He told his children, you know what? If someone is a tyrant, it doesn't matter. You have to, you know, sacrifice your family. Really, save your iman, lose everything else. But the dunya says, lose your iman, save everything else. This is the problem. And this is why we need to follow the madrasa of Ali ibn Abi Talib, which is a madrasa Qur'aniyya. It's a madrasa which is the madrasa of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And based on that, my brothers and sisters, Allah Ta'ala in the Holy Quran, He says, يَعْلَمُ خَائِنَةَ الْأَعْيُنِ. He says, Allah Ta'ala, He knows the khiyana of our eyes. And He knows what we hide in our hearts. And Allah Ta'ala knows what is inside, what is contained in our hearts. In other words, Allah Ta'ala knows our intentions. In other words, in order for us to save God ourselves from hypocrisy, we need to make sure our intentions are pure and sincere. Even if it's cleaning the house of Allah Ta'ala, even if it's reading the Quran, I was reading today. You know the hadith, all actions are according to the intention. I was reading today, you all know the hadith. Hadith is in Bukhari, Muslim. I'm going to finish very soon. But I was reading today before I came, a commentary of this hadith. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he said that the deen of Islam, the foundation of the religion of Islam is based on three authentic prophetic narrations. What are they? This hadith of the niyyah. The second hadith where Sayyidah Aisha Umm al-Mu'mineen, salamullahi ta'ala alayha, she said that whoever innovates in our religion something which is contrary to the Quran and the authentic Sunnah, that is the exact meaning of the hadith, then that is an innovation. And the third hadith, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal said, which is the foundation of the religion of Islam, which hadith is what? Where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa said in Sahih Muslim, Al-halalu bayyinun, that halal is clear and haram is clear. These three narrations are the foundation of our religion. But let me tell you something interesting. Talking about the niyyah, my brothers and sisters. Imam Ibn Jarir, Ja'far Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, the great Mufassir, the great historian, he said, and also along with him, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, said, and Hassan al-Basri, and Abu Darda radiallahu ta'ala anhu. They said that, because I'm saying rectify, when I say that we need to rectify our intentions, why do I need to say that? Is it because all intentions are bad? No. Because sometimes we make an intention, but the intentions change because of all the impurities around us. I'll give you an example. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, Hassan al-Basri, and Abu Darda radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they said that if someone is teaching the Quran, how good is teaching the Quran? Is there anything better than teaching the Quran? He says, if someone teaches the Quran, but his niyyah at the beginning was, I'm teaching the Quran for the sake of Allah. Besides, Quran teachers don't get that much money, so they can say, I'm teaching Quran so that I get paid so much, because Quran teachers don't get money. And this is the sad reality as well. We need to work on this. You know, we pay so much money for a private school, but to pay a madrasa, it has to be very cheap. So again, mentalities. But the point is, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, Abu Darda, and Hassan al-Basri, they said, if someone is teaching the Quran, his intention at the beginning was pure. I'm teaching for the sake of Allah. After he started teaching, now he has 100 students. Now he's known as the most famous Quran teacher. Now if he starts saying, you know what? You know, there's no one like me. You know, if the intention changes a little bit, all his deeds and everything will corrupt everything. In other words, he will have to rectify his intention. So let's look into our lives. Sometimes we do a lot of things, but the moment ostentation, show, riya comes into it. Oh, you know what? I did this. I gave this much. I did that. The moment you say that, the scholars say, the moment you need to do tawbah and rectify your niyyah. To the extent the scholars, they said that sometimes even the prayer, but they said that the prayer will be accepted as long as you pray properly. But the point is, even if someone starts showing and boasting, things can get problematic. The niyyah has to be rectified and corrected. It has to be purified, my brothers and sisters. And you know why the niyyah is so powerful? Let me finish with the example. Example I was giving, someone comes and gives 30 million. Draft. Right now. I wish someone comes right now. And if there's someone who can give, stand. And if there's someone, if you have the money, if you have 1.3 million, give. And if you don't make the intention, I gave an example, if someone gives 1.3 million, is it better to give that money oh, is it more reward to give that money or is it more reward to make an intention? It's more reward to make the intention. You know why? Right now there could be someone, we don't know, there's someone sitting here right now, we don't know who made that intention. Do we know who made the intention? Who knows? Allah Ta'ala knows. And guess what? One of the scholars said, I believe it's Hassan al-Basri or Imam Junaid Baghdadi, one of them, if my memory corrects me, they said that sincerity, a sincere intention, sincerity is a secret that the angels can't even write that down. If you intend something sincerely, the angels can't write it down, it goes direct to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why Sayyidina Imam Ali, he said, what did he say? He said that a good intention is more rewarding than a good action. You know why? If that person gave $30 million right now, and now if that same person goes and he goes around openly, he says, oh, I gave $30 million, you know? Well, I gave it to them. It's me. It's because of me. Erased. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la tubtilu sadaqatikum bil manni كالذي ينفق ماله رياء الناس ولا يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر. You thought that was your money? It's Allah's money. But if someone, if a faqir said, Ya Allah Ta'ala, I make the intention. And if the intention was clean, he gets the intention of donating $30 million. But please, I know Brother Nur Hassan is going to be coming shortly. When he asks for money, and if you have money, don't say, you know what, I made the intention, I don't need to give now. Let's not try to play games with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why I finish with the saying of Baba Bhule Shah, who said, he said, Jai Rab Milda Na Teya To Teya. He says, if we were able to find Allah by having a bath, you know, sometimes you do ghusl, we say Subhanallah. I am Subhanallah. You know, I've reached maqam, great maqam. There's no wali bigger than me. Because I'm so clean, you know. I spend 1 hour shampoo using this shower gel. Jai Rab Milda Na Teya To Teya Te Milda Taduwa Nashwanu Te Jai Rab Milda Jangal Be Minda gaya bachyanu te je rab milda vich masiti te minda chhan chhadkiya bhule sha rab ona Nita jina diya sachiyan.